published and unpublished data. And I think I should now can you see my screen?
Yes, it is good, Gati. It's good.
Okay, good.
Yeah, it's fine. It's fine now.
Okay. So, today I would like to talk to you about some obstacles that we have if we want to study root adaptation under standard lab conditions. And you might maybe wonder why I will talk today about root illumination and maybe even what's the role of sucrose supplementation during our experiments. So roots are the hidden half of the plant. We have the two organs, the shoot and the root, and plants evolved in a way that they adapt their growth both in concert but also separately. And to study the adaptation processes of the root in the soil is quite difficult. So therefore, to make the roots accessible for biochemistry, molecular biology, phenotypical analysis, and for microscopy, and to keep them in a constant environment and to always have them visible, scientists grow seedlings on medium, on plates. And that brings some difficulties for the roots, because roots evolve to grow in the dark. So today I will speak to you about what are the possibilities to study roots in a more natural condition. And the other thing is we are often supplementing growth medium with sucrose to speed up the growth and to keep the plants comfortable. And this has also some backdrops. So we will discuss this on several levels, from macroscopic to microscopic level of plant growth. So the root is a very complex organ. It consists of out of the primary root. The primary root can direct the growth direction. It can also stop to grow depending on the environmental conditions. It can outgrow lateral roots to grow into areas where it's more beneficial for the root. The root consists of several tissues radially organized from the vasculature, followed by several tissues and covered by the endodermis that we will discuss a lot today. And the root is also divided into different zones of development. So we have the stem cell area in the meristematic zone, where new cells are produced and the cells maturate by being pushed up by new cells and mature in this direction towards the elongation zone. And then when they are fully differentiated in the maturation zone, roots are able to outgrow so-called root hairs out of the epidermis. And the root hairs are very important for the plant survival, as they expand the root hair root surface and are responsible for uptaking water and nutrients and everything what the plant needs from the soil. As I told you, the root is constantly evaluating the situation where it is growing into, and it can either stop cell proliferation. It can modulate elongation of the root to modulate the direction of the root growth. It can either grow positively or it can regulate negatively the growth direction to either grow towards beneficial areas or to avoid harmful areas in the soil. Like, for example, if there are heavy metals, if there is salt, if there is not enough water. So the root is very flexible. And if it's very bad, the primary root will stop to grow. So it will stop produce new cells and it will generate new lateral roots. So it's always in, the plant is always in motion. And today I will explain you the role of one signaling molecule in a plant, auxin, how it is modulating root growth adaptation, and how auxin signaling interferes with exogenous environmental signals, like, as I said, light or sugar signaling, and how this is influencing on a macroscopic level root architecture establishment. And then I will focus on one paper that we recently published to combining all of these three signaling pathways. And then I will show you on microscopic level how the auxin carrier PIN2 is modulating depending on differential root illumination starting. Yeah, so to start with the auxin distribution in plants is auxin modulates many developmental and growth adaptation processes, and it does it about its signaling pathways, and it is always transported to the part of the plant where the action is needed. So the plant responds to, it's combining exogenous and endogenous signaling pathways and is modulating root growth accordingly. And for this, you need a signaling molecule that is actively and directly transported to the area of action. And when we say auxin, we mean a group of molecules. And the most abundant auxin in plant is indole acetic acid, and it is a weak acid. And it means when you transport it over the plant from cell to cell, it is trapped in the cytoplasm because of changes of the pH. And this makes it possible for the plant to direct the flow of the signaling molecules through the plant. So most of the auxin is produced in young leaves. And then depending how the signaling cues are coming into the plant, it is transported all over the plant by a machinery of auxin transporters. And we have like the OX1 and LUX1 auxin influx carrier family that is enhancing auxin flow from cell to cell in a certain direction. And then we have the PIN auxin efflux carrier family. These are proteins that are polarly aligned at the plasma cell membrane, directing in where the molecule is further transported from cell to cell. So that's a mechanism that allows the plant to on point modulate auxin maxima and minima. And then in the target cell, auxin signaling events take place and the cell can react to all the signals that are incoming into the plant. So mostly we have over the steel transport down to the root tip, and we will see how this works in detail here. So the pin efflux family consists of 8 members, and all of them are located either differently in the cell or in different tissues in the plant. And they are modulated in a way that the plant is canalizing the molecule flow from the shoot area down to the very root tip. And in the root tip, you have, by co-working of several family members of the pin family, you have a fountain model where auxin is circulating and transporting always to the area where it's at the moment needed. So I'm mostly working with the family member pin 2, which is responsible to transport auxin shootwards up over the epidermis to modulate adaptation processes and root development in the very root tip. So as I mentioned, pin 2 is very important to maintain the root growth processes in the root tip. And it starts with being important for root length modulation, but also for transporting auxin towards higher areas in the maturating root, where auxin signaling is crucial for proper establishment of root hair outgrowth. So when you have accumulation of auxin in the meristematic area, in the stem cell area of the root, you will enhance cell proliferation, and then you need auxin in the maturating cells up to the elongation zone, where you also modulate the cell fate establishment of root hair cells. And then later on, you need auxin signaling events to modulate root hair elongation according to the needs of the plants to be able to take up all the nutrients and all the water that the plant needs. And when we are then going on the cellular and subcellular level, it gets very complex, because all this concept of the pin proteins is that the protein is polarly localized in the cell to drive the auxin flow in a certain direction. That means the protein needs to be expressed and intercalated into the plasma membrane at a certain area. And to modulate and to coordinate the localization of the pin proteins, several cellular events are involved. As the pin proteins are continuous cycling in the cell, and they're also moving along the plasma membrane, there are mechanisms that modulate their intracellular trafficking. We involved our cytoskeleton, like the microtubules, and we have the endosome pathway. And there is also one, so this is a picture of an actual cell. And you see that the pin protein, pin 2, is localized intracellularly in different intracellular compartments. And at the end, it is eventually transported to the lytic vacuole that is responsible for the breakdown of proteins that are not needed anymore. So there is a a fine modulated interplay of different cellular processes that modulate the localization of the protein on subcellular level, but also the abundance level. And at the end, if a cell wants to get rid of a protein, it is always transporting it to the lytic vacuole. So you always have also on cellular level balancing mechanism to modulate the direction of auxin flow. So as it was mentioned before, I started during my PhD thesis to understand which mechanism and which modifications post-translationally are involved into the modulation of PIN2 abundance at the plasma membrane. And in this scheme, we are now zooming again more into the subcellular level at the plasma membrane, how the PIN proteins look like. So we have two transmembrane domains, the intercalating the protein into the plasma membrane, and then the PIN proteins possess a cytoplasmic loop, and in this cytoplasmic loop, individual PIN proteins have either conserved or individual motifs for post-translational modifications, and very prominent ones are the one for phosphorylation, which can modulate and orchestrate the localization of the PIN protein in the cell, that it always is transported to the area where it should be. It is also known that some phosphorylation sites are responsible for the activity of PIN proteins. And what we were studying were other post-translational modifications. One was the involvement of two conserved cysteines, which we could show that they are important for the patterning of the PIN2 protein along the plasma membrane. And another post-translational modification that was studied in the lab and is crucial for the trafficking towards the lytic vacuole is ubiquitination. So all plasma membrane proteins, when they need to be degraded in the lytic vacuole, they have to be tagged by a polyubiquitin chain. This will be recognized and the membrane protein will be transported for degradation to the lytic vacuole. So just to summarize, it's a small sketch, what happens when we mess around with the post-translational modification is normally PIN2 protein is localized polarly to transport auxin shootwards from cell to cell. And then you have like standard root growth. If you knock out the PIN2 efflux carrier and there is no PIN2 action, you start to get randomized root growth because auxin cannot be transported anymore in an organized way. And the root doesn't really know to grow in how to grow in which direction. And when you mutate the cysteines and exchange them to alanines, you alter the localization along the patterning of PIN2 along the plasma membrane, and you get an enhanced internalization of the PIN2 protein. You slightly start to mess up with the growth of the root. It's making a more wavy growth pattern. But when you artificially add ubiquitin into the PIN2 sequence, you stimulate and enhance uptake of PIN2 into towards a lytic vacuole. That means that you have much less of the PIN2 at the plasma membrane, and then you get again randomized growth of the root because you mess up with the coordination of auxin transport again. So to summarize, you need targeted, organized auxin transport in the root tip to maintain proper root growth and root development. And PIN2 is an essential protein to orchestrate this. And now to switch to light signaling and roots. For several years, several groups, and especially the lab of Balushka, mentioned already that maybe it's not suitable to grow plants exposed fully to light. And in several papers, he showed that roots are able to sense light in the very root tip, and depending which wavelength they sense, they will either stop growing or they will initiate growth away from the light source. And in 2015, another paper was published showing the impact of direct light illumination on root growth adaptation. And in the lab of Juan Carlos del Pozo, they produced this box where you can put your plate and seedlings at the edge of this D-root box, and the roots will grow shaded from light, and the shoot will grow exposed to light, which represents a more natural way of growing roots. And to summarize most of the studies, so they published 2016, 2019 further papers showing the influence on different metabolomic and root growth adaptation processes. There are quite evident differences between light grown and dark grown roots. For example, they differ in nutrient uptake. They have a different expressed set of genes, a different set of metabolome. They have shorter roots growing in the light because of the stress response in the meristem. And what was for me very striking, they respond differently to exogenous application of different substances. For example, what caught my eye especially was that they obviously differently reacted to an artificial auxin that was applied. And then I started to be more interested in this D-root system and applied it for myself in the lab. And here I would like only to mention, I tried different ways to cover the roots, and there are more that are more suitable and some that are less suitable. For example, I would not recommend to use aluminium foil to cover up your roots, because through the light reflections from the aluminium foil down the root, you get a quite stressed root phenotype. And I would also not recommend to use velvet, because velvet is accumulating heat in the plate and the plants suffer a lot. But what you can do if you don't want to organize the pre-made D-root boxes, you can use some stiff black paper and make this D-root sleeves by yourself. It's working fine. So a lot of groups are using the system nowadays. Yeah, so to continue what's going on in the root tip on cellular level, when you shade them from direct root illumination, you have a more active meristem in the darkened roots. So you see over time that the darkened roots are growing longer. And also how they grow differs, the patterning of the lateral root is different, the waviness of the root is different. And they also checked the elongation pattern of cells when they are growing out of the meristem and start to mature. They start also to elongate, and this is also then the zone where you have all the directional growth regulations of the root happening. They measured under dark and light growth conditions the elongation potential of the cells that are maturing, and they could see that although you have like more cells, they are then in the elongation zone a bit shorter. And this is some. Oops. So can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Sorry. And this is also something that I could then directly observe when I was continuously observing the growth of roots, is that in a time frame of 6 hours, the shaded cells were elongating less than they were when they were exposed fully to light. So you have some compensatory mechanism, obviously. So to finalize, to summarize the impact of light, so direct root illumination has a quite strong effect on differential root zone behavior of the root. And what I would like you to remember for now is that direct light illumination is inhibiting cell proliferation. Now to explain a little bit the impact of exogenous sucrose supplementation to the medium, of course, you push them. So if you add sucrose to the medium, they grow nicer, they are more active, and you can nicely track your root growth, but this is not what is happening in nature. And on the field, you have the situation that carbohydrate, sucrose, sugar content is highly dependent on the photosynthetic activity of the plant. It means of how much light, how much sun there is at the moment available for the plant. And like when you add sugar, you interfere with all of this fine-tuning mechanism that a plant has to modulate root growth adaptation. So shoot and root are constantly communicating with each other. You have sucrose and other sugars, and auxin produced in the leaves, they are transported down to the root where they can orchestrate root growth adaptation, including the outgrow of root hairs, and the root hairs will provide water and nutrients to the plant, and it will be transported to the shoot. So in general, you have always like a certain amount of energy that the plant can consume, and then it must household, and it will either push the growth of the shoot or the growth of the root. And it's like always a forth and back to build up the best with what the plant can get. There are some papers that already showed how exogenous sugar supplementation is also interfering with the auxin biosynthesis in the root itself. There is one paper that showed from the Laxmi lab that exogenous glucose supplementation is again increasing in root length because sucrose is pushing cell proliferation in the meristem. You have also a differential growth of lateral roots and also a differential outgrowth of root hairs. But on the other hand, you have a more randomized growth of the root tip itself. That means that you divergent more from vertical. So the gravitropic index of the plant is different depending if you apply or don't apply glucose to the medium. And there was another publication recently that was showing that if you apply 1% sucrose, to induce auxin biosynthesis by 3 times in the root tips. And if you have, for example, 3% sucrose, I think it was 7 times more auxin in the root tip. So of course, if you have more auxin, you differently modulate root growth response in the root tip. And this would not reflect responses in nature. So I was wondering what happens now when we bring all of the players together: direct rutile remission, sucrose supplementation, and the involvement of the PIN2 auxin efflux carrier. So we published at the beginning of the year with two students that are working with me this paper dissecting the hierarchies between light, sugar, and auxin action that are underpinning root and root hair growth. And on macroscopic level, we compared what is happening when we are leaving one of the components out. And this is the experimental setup. We were growing seedlings with roots exposed to the light grown roots, and we were comparing them to the dark grown roots. And we were comparing a line that is expressing PIN2 at wild type levels, and we were comparing it to a mutant line that is not expressing the PIN2 efflux carrier at all. And then we were measuring different root traits. We measured the total root lengths. We measured the distance from the very root tip to the first emerging root hair. We evaluated the gravitropic index, and we were especially having a good look on root hair initiation, outgrowth, and elongation depending on the conditions. So first of all, when PIN2 is expressed and we compare the root lengths, we could reproduce the data of our colleagues from the Deposa lab. So this was fine. And we could see that there is a very significant difference in root lengths establishment when we compare dark grown roots grown on sucrose and light grown roots on sucrose. But there is not really a difference when you leave the sucrose out. So as I said, light is negatively interfering with the meristematic activity of roots. Sucrose is pushing. So there is no wonder that we see under these conditions higher differences. Whereas when we leave out the sucrose, we have less meristematic activity. There is not such a huge difference in the total root length establishment. When we are looking on the Pentoo mutant, we already see the difference is that the root length difference between dark grown and light grown roots on sucrose is a little bit smaller, which is in concert with formerly published data that showed that Pin2 action is also necessary for establishment of root lengths. And so what we can take out of this scheme is that sucrose is massively pushing root growth, and when we take out Pin2 as a player, it is reduced. Then we looked on the root hair growth under different growth conditions. We could see that there, among all of the growth conditions, when we compared the appearance of the first root hair, there is no significant difference. So no statistical significant difference when it is appearing. But again, and this is also consistent with previously published results, that in the Pin2 mutant, root hairs appear later. So you can see it here. You will have more longer and earlier appearing root hairs when you have Pin2 mediated shootward auxin transport. And then we had a look on the amount and the length of the root hairs, because Silvana was in the lab of Del Pozo, they described that root hairs that are growing closer to the meristem, they are longer in light growth conditions, which we could again see. Somehow light is triggering the elongation of root hairs. We couldn't see this anymore for dark grown roots, and we only could see this effect of light when sucrose was supplemented. We didn't see it when there was sucrose supplemented to roots expressing Pin2, and the effect when we left out sucrose in the Pin2 mutant was even more striking, because the level of emerging and elongating root has dropped drastically when there was no sucrose. So we were calculating how many root hairs in total are emerging. Then we had a look on the elongation rate of the root hairs. And then again, elongation rate in under wild type Pin2 conditions doesn't differ so much. It's only like the amount of root hairs. But again, in the Pin2 mutant, when you leave out sucrose in the medium, you have a drop in the possibility to elongate the root hair. So then we also measured how far they elongate. And of those that elongated, and like when they once elongate, they elongate in more or less the same level in PIN2 mutant. And again, elongation rate is enhanced in light grown roots. So obviously there is strong interaction of sucrose and auxin signaling that we don't finally understand yet. We are working on it, but you can see by just adding sucrose to the medium, you completely messed up the root hair phenotypes of the PIN2 mutant. And to the gravitropic index, where you measure how far the root tip is divergating from the vertical vector. When you add sucrose, as it was previously described, we could see that independent on the light illumination status of the root, sucrose is strongly enhancing randomized growth of the root tip when PIN2 is expressed, whereas the PIN2 mutant that is anyway agravitropic, there is not such a big difference anymore when you add sucrose to the medium. So summarizing our paper is that you have the three players that are modulating root trait establishments. They are highly interconnected, and especially when you're interested in tracking root trait establishment, I would always recommend to always have a look without sucrose, and maybe also try to shade your roots to see if maybe your mutant is not highly light or sucrose sensitive. So what we are now doing, because I was quite surprised that under the wild type condition, but also in the mutant, you didn't really had a difference when the first root hair is emerging, although you have differences depending on the growth conditions in the meristematic activity, but also in the elongation rate of the cells. So we are at the moment evaluating under different growth conditions how the individual zones, the cells, adapt. And on the first side, it seems there is a buffering mechanism, because if we apply sucrose and light to the medium, or we leave out sucrose in the medium and apply darkness, we always get a different pattern of the length of the transition and the meristematic zone. But if you add them together, you will get more or less the same length of the root tip. So either you have a more active meristem, and then you have a less active elongation zone, and the other way around, which is quite interesting. And we will in future look more closely into this cellular mechanism that are buffering the growth. Yeah, and what happens when you mess around? So if you don't knock out the efflux carrier completely, but if you modulate the post-translational modifications and how PIN2 is trafficked in the cell, is that so when you completely knock out PIN2, they don't sense anymore the differences according to root lengths. So they don't really show differences depending if there is sucrose supplementation or if there is a change in root illumination. When you slightly start to enhance and alter PIN2 distribution in the cell, you have a slow change in how well the root is transmitting signals towards the root tip. And then when you completely induce internalization of PIN2, you again get, like in the PIN2 mutant, a loss for transmitting the endogenous signals towards root growth regulation. And also when you compare the PIN2 cysteine mutant to the wild type PIN2 situation, you can see that it's behaving more than the PIN2 mutant, that it's not any more sensitive towards exogenous growth condition while regulating directional root growth. And also when we were calculating the root hair frequency in the PIN2 cysteine mutant, we could see that the differences that we could see in the other lines, they are lost. So that means that all of these positive modifications are probably needed to transmit all the signals that are incoming towards root growth adaptation. So now, this was on macroscopic level, but what is happening on microscopic level? So like when we look on the intracellular trafficking of PIN2 upon different growth conditions. So in this video, we have a nice look on the plasma membrane where PIN2 is intercalated, and I disturbed with a drug that is interfering with the integrity of microtubules. I trapped PIN2 proteins in these vesicles that are transported through the cell. And and when we're now I will tell you about another obstacle when we faced when we were tracking PIN2 turnover in the cell. And unfortunately, when roots are grown in the light, the vacuole is very acidic. And this was interfering with our ability to track PIN2 in the cell. That was the portion that was transported for lytic degradation to the vacuole. So we simply couldn't, because of technical issues, we couldn't see what's going on in the cell. And only like, few years ago, like 2019, in the paper that we published, we published also a new line, PIN2 tagged to a red fluorescent protein. And this tag is not sensitive anymore to pH changes. That means we could see what's really going on in the cell. And it was a quite a big surprise, you know, between comparing PIN2 tagged to the green fluorescent protein that is highly sensitive to pH. And then we compared this same conditions with a differently tagged fluorescent protein was the ratio between the PIN proteins in the cell compartments compared to the plasma membrane. So what we could see is that light is stabilizing pin 2, and that in the dark grown roots there is a much more active interstellar trafficking going on. And what we then started to do is to repeat all this pharmacological treatments that are known to interfere with PIN2 trafficking in the cell. And one treatment that showed the most different results depending on how the root was grown was when we interfered with oresaline with the microtubule stability. And this first video is showing a light grown root where we applied oresaline, and you see that there are not so many and not very actively moving vesicles harboring PIN2 intracellular. But in the opposite, when we were doing the same treatment for dark grown roots, we got a completely different pattern. So there is more and much more rapid moving vesicles harboring PIN2. And this could be also an indication that the subsoil composition of light and dark grown roots is quite different. And this is more or less one of the biggest topic now of my team, to understand what are the differences on subcellular level between light and dark grown roots. So, and with this, I would like to thank you for your attendance, and I would like to thank the lab and department I'm embedded in, and the financial support that I'm getting. And yeah, I'm happy to take your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rexel, for this nice, informative, and detailed talk. Now the session is open for questions, discussion. So you could write questions in the chat box, or you can also write, you can also use a microphone, ask questions directly, please. So, Dr. Rapsa, then I have one question. PIN2 is it a only a membrane bounding protein, or is it also available in the
No, it's function. It's a plasma. So far we now know is that the function is at the plasma membrane.
But it's not found in the inside the cells or the inside,
so it's trans so it's plasma. Trafficked it's the no regulatory function. Mechanism, so we don't know about the function in the cell so far we see the function at the plasma membrane.
Other than auxin, is there any other mechanism, a regulatory mechanism other than auxin?
Yes, of course. So like for sure, all of the phytohormones, all of the other signaling molecules like calcium and ROS are differently regulated. So primary results from other groups are showing that there are also other signaling pathways differently regulated in dark and light conditions. Mm-hmm. But I'm focusing on the auxin part. Yeah. But all of them are tightly interconnected. So yeah, you don't have one without the other. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? There is a question from Samira Rafiq. Does this root illumination differ with different types of soil?
This is a very good question. And yes, different types of soil have a different possibility to let light through. So you have like a lighter, fluffier soil that will leave more light through the soil, and then you will have more compact soil. And this is also for sure individually, must be individually examined, depending how the root is adapting, how much light is going through, what's the composition of the soil. So this is from area to area for sure different. Yeah, this is a very good question. Yeah.
Then Sibu sir has a question, sir, please.
Okay, Kathy, very nice talk. I mean, you invest a lot of time, a lot of work. Kathy, so a few years back, there was a paper where they were saying that it's the normal way of how we are growing the plants. It's not really right. I mean, we should always grow the plants the way you are growing. I mean, the root part should be grown in dark and the shoot part should be under light. That is the more proper way of growing the plants in vitro. So in a way, are you also recommending this? That so we cannot taken it granted that we can simply sow the plants on the plate and simply we can grow under light right away, or we have to be careful. So are you in a way recommending this as well?
It always depends what you want to target with your work. So if you say I'm working and examining how the root is interacting with the environment, mm-hmm. I think that you will not be able to transfer the knowledge from basic to applied science. So we have a lot of situation where field trials fail. Because you cannot reproduce data. So it always depends. Of course, it's easier, it's faster. You can do a lot on light grown roots, but it always depends what's your message at the end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Anyway, it's quite clear that you know light has quite a profound effect. I mean, in cell biology, in terms of pins and vascular degradation, there is a profound effect. Often, probably the things what we are addressing or the things what we are claiming probably it, not really in actual terms, actually. No,
I think what you see, it's like you address the light avoidance. So for the root, the light avoidance response. So mm-hmm. what you then see is like what is happening. So roots in nature also tend to grow away from light. So this mechanism, mm-hmm. what you see is like the light avoidance mechanism. Yeah, yeah. So this is like always, if you're studying cellular mechanism, you know, it's one part. But if you then try to transfer it to what is on macro, so, you know, what's the physiological relevance of the work and how you interpret like macroscopic and microscopic data together. Yeah, and then we have discrepancies. And I see when you avoid like growing them in light, that it's like stress and inducing several cellular mechanism that you maybe would not have mm-hmm. in soil. And then also especially there is this big impact when you have sugar supplementation and light, it's much more dynamic, the response, that if you have sucrose and dark grown roots. So like there is not so much impact of sucrose and dark grown roots mm-hmm. compared to sucrose and light grown roots.
So
there's a lot of things going on cellular level.
And also you are using aluminium foil to generate the dark.
Not aluminium foil. So use aluminium foil.
Because it will have some protection.
You get an intermediate phenotype because of the light that is ping ponging. I'm using the system that the Del Pozzo lab invented. So this was what it allows me to, like fast and consistent work. We also like produced like our own in our own workshop, but people are also using like stable black paper. And they are just making these boxes out of stiff paper, and it's working the same. So now, meanwhile, almost 20 labs that we are connected using that U-root system in different forms. And we are the nice thing is that we very consistent in reproducing phenotypes or root growth adaptation. So this is very nice. So if you use the D-root system, you're also much more consistent among the groups.
Yeah, because I was wondering when you mentioned that the first root hair, that is the one you are trying to follow up. So I was wondering the effect on first root hair, is it somehow coming from the light, you know, even if you grow in the light?
So because... an indication could be from the paper Silva Navas 20 and 16, where they are showing that the ROS levels are elevated in light-grown roots, and ROS signaling is quite a strong triggering mechanism for the elongation rate and root outgrowth. So one of the next steps for sure also for me is to look into like ROS waving and ROS signaling. So I think that you are here interfering with like the stress response and the developmental response of the plant.
Okay. Thank you,
So any other questions, please? You can ask directly. So if there is no question, so I'll ask one more question about the gene. Is it a single gene product? Is PIN?
So PIN2 is a member of a family, but it is expressed. The expression pattern is individual, so it's like not expressed with other PIN proteins in the same area of the root. So PIN2 is only expressed in the root cap and in the epidermis and in the cortex in the root tip, and there are no other PIN proteins overlapping in the area of action of PIN2. So it's a member of a protein family, but it's the expression pattern is individual.
Individual. So any more questions? You could also ask directly if you want.
We can go to the conclusion then.
Janice, please.
Siva sir.
Hello?
Yeah, Barna, yeah.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Now I request Ms. Anisri for delivering the vote of thanks. Anisri?
Yes, I'm. Am I audible enough?
Yes.
Yeah.
Hello. A lovely evening, everyone. It's an honor to have been asked to offer a word of thanks on the occasion of the international webinar series conducted in MACFest. I take this opportunity to give a thank you note to everyone for making today's session a fruitful one. I, on behalf of the MACFest community, spread my most sincere thanks to our principal, Reverend Father Seryan J. Kotel, for providing the opportunity. I wholeheartedly express my gratitude towards you, Father. Further, I take this occurrence to thank the speaker for the day, Dr. Redzer, Institute of Experimental Botany of Zeish Academy of Sciences. Ma'am, you gave us the deep insights into the topic. I, on behalf of the MACFest family, extend our gratitude towards you, ma'am, for accepting the invitation and conducting this webinar. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
Next, I take the opportunity. Thank you. Next, I take the opportunity to thank the brain behind the wall, the head of the department, School of Biosciences, Dr. Jenny Jacob. Without your initiative and support, this would neither be a huge success. Thank you, ma'am. Next, I take the moment to thank the coordinator, Dr. Sibu Simon, for organizing the program in a befitting manner. and also all other faculty members who worked along with him. Thank you, everyone. Further, I would like to extend my generous thanks to Dean of School of Biosciences, Dr. Beena Charyan, for her cooperation and keen support throughout. Thank you, ma'am. Further, taking this opportunity, I would like to mention a deep sense of appreciation to our research director, Dr. Jyotish Kumar, for his constant guidance and morale boosting. Thank you, sir. Finally, all the participants out there, you were great listeners. Thank you, everyone, for making this event a fruitful one. Thank you. Stay safe and have a wonderful day ahead.
Okay, Kathy.
So thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure.
So hope we can connect with you again in the future.
Yeah. Would be fine. So take care and be in touch.
Take care.
And have a nice day, a nice weekend.
Sure. Okay, Kathy. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. So please remember, the feedback link is given in the chat box. So please remember to fill it before you leave.